Hello and welcome to another in the series, series of eight, taking a look at the organic structure questions from Module 2, GCE Chemistry, and specifically looking at the structured questions. A separate snapcast has been produced that looks at the short response questions in eight consecutive papers, that is the organic short response. Do pause and have a go. What do you need for 3 marks here? First of all, which one represents low-density polythene? The answer is B for a mark. And a second mark for indicating the fact that we can see it has branching, whereas high-density does not have branching. Then we've got to explain this flexibility and softening based on the branching. Because the branching produces a more open structure, with weaker van der Waals forces between the molecules, this gives it greater flexibility and a lower softening temperature. So a mark for B, a mark for branching, and a mark for saying that branching results in a more open structure with these weaker bonds between the molecules. Moving on, pause and have a go. 4 marks here, plus 2 for quality of communication. Do pause and have a go, and I recommend you try out both. Do both high density and low densities industrial production. Let's look at them one at a time. When you've tried it, answers coming up here. First of all, high density polyethylene. In a moment we'll see for low density polyethylene we use a higher temperature. We also use a high pressure, but here it's carried out at somewhere between 30 and 120 degrees centigrade. Remember the name of the catalyst. I suggest you remember the Ziegler-Natta catalyst. The ethene, or old name ethylene, is dissolved in paraffin to be fed into the reaction chamber. And at the end of the product, the polymer is recovered by simply cooling or by evaporation of the solvent. So a number of places you can pick up your marks, but of key importance, clearly the temperature, the name of the catalyst, what the ethene is dissolved in, and how you recover the product, and string this together well for the 2 marks for quality of written communication. Then let's take a look at low density polyethylene, should you choose that. Temperature range 100 to 300 degrees centigrade. On this occasion, a very, very high pressure. Then helping the process, clearly oxygen is the easiest example to remember here, but if you've learned one of the others, that's fine as well. The solvent is either benzene or chlorobenzene. And the use of water to dissipate the heat, since the polymerization is a very exothermic process, and you want to maintain the temperature in this range. So what would you remember here? And remember, you've also got the other 2 marks for quality of written communication: the temperature, the high pressure, the solvent, the use of oxygen in the process, use of water to dissipate the heat. Moving on, pause and have a go. The same is true of all these addition polymers, polythene, PVC, polystyrene, etc. What's the problem for a mark? And what are the 2 main methods used to dispose of it? Answers coming up. Problem is, addition polymers are non-biodegradable. The organisms in the ground will not be able to decompose them. It'll take many hundreds of years before they break down by physical processes. And 2 methods mostly used for dealing with these non-biodegradable plastics: dumped in landfill sites or incinerated. I noticed that recycling isn't mentioned there, but I would have hoped that they would have accepted recycling. But those are certainly the 2 main methods. Here we have thionyl chloride, the chloridating agent. Pause and have a go. Not perhaps as hard as it appears. Sulfur has a valency of 2. Oxygen has a valency of 2. Chlorine has a valency of 1. So, think in terms of how these might be joined together. Well, right away we see that this won't work. So one of them is going to have to expand its octet, and the question does help us with this. It states that sulfur forms 4 bonds. So we must have S with 4 different bonds. Think of how these might be put together. Sulfur connected to the oxygen perhaps, and then separately bonded to the chlorines. And sulfur has expanded its octet here to 4. You'll have come across examples like SF6 or S. In this particular structure, fluorine or sulfur has expanded its octet well beyond the 8 electrons in the valence shell, and it's expanding its octet here as well. This results from something known as hybridization, a topic that goes beyond A level, but I have produced a separate snapcast on that. It's in the atomic theory section. Best just to simply remember this structure. Let's look at the Mark scheme answer. Okay, moving on. Pause and have a go. You're looking to form 4 grams of thionyl chloride. And we've got to calculate the volume of this required. So we'll have to work that out in cubic decimeters or cubic centimeters. First thing we'll have to do is work out what this is in terms of moles of SOCl2. So with one sulfur, the relative atomic mass of sulfur is 32, one oxygen, 16, and two chlorines, 2 times 35.5 gives us 71. We add all of that up, 119. So we'll work out the number of moles of SOCl2 and 4 grams. So 4.0 grams of SOCl2 is equal to the mass, 4.0 divided by the relative molecular mass, 119 mole. Let's see what that comes out to be. That's 0.0336 mole. Now if we look at the equation, we see that 1 mole of SO2 is required to make 1 mole of SOCl2. So we need the same number of moles of SO2. And it wants us to work out the volume at 20 degrees C and 1 atmosphere. You notice within the same set of exams, they sometimes refer to room temperature as 20 and on other occasions at 25. So it requires this number of moles. Let's convert it to dm cubed now by multiplying the number of moles by the number of cubic decimeters in a mole at room temperature and pressure. So it's 0.0336 multiplied by 24 cubic decimeters. See what that comes out to be. That's 0.8064 dm cubed. Or we could leave it as cubic centimeters. That would be 806.4 cubic centimeters. The thionyl chloride is mixed with phosphorus oxychloride, which we're told has another liquid with a boiling point of 107. The boiling point of the thionyl chloride was given 78 degrees centigrade. So the boiling points are quite a bit apart. What would we use for 2 marks? Here's the answer coming up. 2 marks for distillation and simple distillation. Now the reason for this is because their boiling points are reasonably far apart, the difference between 78 and 107 is almost 30 degrees, 29 degrees C difference. And there's a rule of thumb, if the boiling points differ by 20 degrees centigrade or more, then simple distillation gives satisfactory separation. So simple distillation in this case. And anything coming off below 100 degrees centigrade should be your more volatile component, which is your thionyl chloride, the product you're looking for. Seems to be they've made a mistake here, obviously, because 0.82 dm³, which is roughly what we got, we did it somewhat more accurately. They've rounded it up here at this stage. We got, but you can see that to change from dm³ to cm³, you multiply by 1,000, move it 3 decimal places, so that should actually say 806.7 cubic centimeters. Moving on. Pause and have a go, please. You are aware from your syllabus of the reaction between an alcohol and thionyl chloride, SOCl2. It chlorinates the alcohol, removes the OH and replaces it with Cl, so you get an alkyl halide, chloroalkane. And you should be aware that you also get two gases, SO2, sulfur dioxide, and hydrogen chloride gas. So if it was to work with water, think of water as being HOH. So it's H2O. We're going to get plus SOCl2. That's going to form, instead of the R going with the Cl, we're getting H going with Cl. So you're going to get HCl plus SO2 plus HCl again. So effectively you're getting 2HCl plus SO2. Pause and have a go at this. 3 marks here, and you have to go the whole hog. You've got to have the 2 steps. There's 2 stages to this particular test. Can you remember what they are? You'd be adding acidified silver nitrate for a start. And what would be happening with the chloride ions? They would react with silver ions in solution to form insoluble silver chloride. What happens next? Well, silver chloride, unlike silver bromide, is soluble in dilute ammonia. So having got the white precipitate, you would show that it redissolves in dilute ammonia, an emphasis on dilute ammonia. Let's look at the mark scheme answers. Acidified silver nitrate produces a white precipitate that is soluble in, didn't put in dilute, but I would advise you add dilute ammonia. That's distinct from silver bromide, which is an off-white precipitate, which is insoluble in dilute ammonia, but soluble in concentrated ammonia. And you saw we got 2HCl and SO2. Moving on. Pause and have a go here. Well, ethanol is CH3CH2OH. We're reacting it with SOCl2. And as I showed on the last slide, that's going to replace the OH here with the Cl. So we'll get CH3CH2Cl. And we also get SO2 gas and HCl gas. And this question, have a go. It's a ratio question again. All of these add up to 100, so it's percentage by mass. We work out the ratios then. We've got hydrogen to nitrogen to sulfur to oxygen. In terms of grams, we've got 1.6 grams of this, 22.2 grams of this, 50.8 grams of this, and 25.4 grams of this. We convert them to moles now by dividing each by its relative atomic mass, so that's 1.6 divided by 1, 22.4 divided by 14, 50.8 divided by 32, 25.4 divided by 16. So this is 1.6. The next one is 1.6. The next one is 1.6, and the next one is 1.6. So they're present in the ratio 1 to 1 to 1 to 1. If we divide across by 1.6, it's 1 to 1 to 1 to 1. So the empirical form is simply one of each. It'll be HNSO. That's the empirical formula. Moving on. Pause and have a go, please. We use lime water, of course. And what do we expect to happen? Carbon dioxide turns lime water cloudy. Do you know the chemical name for lime water? It's a very dilute solution of this. Calcium hydroxide is only slightly soluble. So if you put some calcium hydroxide solid into water, a little bit will dissolve. You'd need to filter it to get the filtrate, which will be a dilute solution of calcium hydroxide, and that's lime water. And what happens then when you bubble CO2 gas through? What is it that makes it go cloudy? You get calcium carbonate, which is insoluble. What's the other product? Water. Have a look at the mark scheme answer. That's correct. Lime water turns milky or cloudy. In GCSE, the word cloudy seems to be favoured. Here they talk about milky. Okay, pause and have a go. When it comes to alcohols being soluble, what's the main thing we're looking for? Hydrogen bonds, of course. So we've got to state about hydrogen bonds. What else do we have to say? Probably just that because it can hydrogen bond and water can hydrogen bond, the two can hydrogen bond together and are therefore soluble or miscible with one another. Soluble in one another or miscible with one another. And beneficial and harmful effects of alcohol. Alcohol, for example, is a tremendous solvent. It's used in cosmetics and other places. Let's take a look at the answers. What did you come up with for harmful effects there? Here are the answers coming up. So you got a mark for drawing the structure of ethanol. Make sure that you read the question carefully. And mentioning the hydrogen bonds that can form with water. Damage to the liver. I would suggest its use as a solvent is just as good an answer as a relaxant. That when you drink alcohol, it helps you to relax, as long as you're doing it in moderation. Moving on. Pause and have a go. Have a go at this. State two reasons why chlorine can be regarded as a catalyst. Now you could be misled here a little bit. One might be tempted to say that it's a catalyst because it's not being used up in the reaction. But really what it's asking for here is what does a catalyst do? And then state a chemical test for chlorine. 2 marks. When you're ready, we'll have a look at the answer. First of all, what's happening here? The first step then, a bit like in the reaction of methane with chlorine in the presence of light, the chlorine molecules break down to form chlorine atoms, which have an unpaired electron and can therefore be called radicals as well. Then one of those chlorine radicals hits the ozone, O3, creating oxygen plus ClO, and the unpaired electron now is on the ClO. That ClO then hits an oxygen atom. Remember, an oxygen atom, oxygen's atomic number 8, configuration 2-6. So unlike a chlorine atom, an oxygen atom does not have an unpaired electron. It has 6 electrons in its outer shell. So the ClO radical hits an oxygen atom, and this splits then, creating O2. Might be worth looking at this ClO and do the Lewis diagram for this. There are the chlorine 7 electrons, the oxygen's electrons and dots 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is our unpaired electron in ClO. This then splits as follows. Splits like that. So the chlorine gets its 7 electrons back, and then we'll have an unpaired electron, which is what we're seeing here. This oxygen comes off with its 6 electrons. This oxygen here is 6 electrons, and of course they form that double bond like so. And that accounts for all the electrons if you want to just track where the electrons are coming and going. So pause and have a look at those equations. Get rid of the scribbles to help you see what's there. There's an alternative to that first step, as you see there, but I would go for this one. Chlorine molecule forming, breaking to form two chlorine atoms with an unpaired electron. They're also radicals. One of those chlorine radicals hitting ozone O3, creating oxygen plus a ClO radical. And the ClO radical is hitting an oxygen atom, forming oxygen and a chlorine radical, keeping the process going. These are doubly bad then, these chlorine radicals, because look what's happening. The chlorine radical is breaking down the ozone there into oxygen, but it's also, in producing this, this goes on and is using up these oxygen atoms in the atmosphere, which if they were left alone would react with oxygen to form ozone. And then two reasons why chlorine can be regarded as a catalyst. What they were looking for is the fact that it speeds the reaction up, lowers the activation energy, or provides an alternative pathway, as opposed to stating in this case that it's not used up. It does state that they're unchanged as another reason. There had been two marks for this, so unchanged lowers the activation energy, perhaps, is what I would have thought of. Chemical test for chlorine. Chlorine is a bleach, and if you take damp indicator paper, damp UI or damp litmus paper, it will decolorize it. In that context, bleach means to decolorize. So bleaches kill germs, but they also remove color. Be clear about that then. You take damp litmus paper, probably, let's say damp blue litmus, and it will make it go white. What actually happens is, if you take damp blue litmus, chlorine will dissolve in the moisture to form a mixture of acids, hypochlorous acid and hydrochloric acid. And of course they're acidic and they will turn the damp blue litmus red. But within moments, the red will go white. So chlorine's actually initially turning it from blue, the damp indicator paper, from blue to red, but then very quickly turning it white because it's a bleach. Note, it should be damp. You need something for the chlorine to dissolve in to produce the bleach. Moving on. Pause and have a go. Propagation reactions must have a radical on the left and a radical on the right. Termination reactions always involve a radical reacting with a radical to form a neutral product. And explain the role of the light. When you're ready, here are the answers coming up. Typical propagation reaction where one of the chlorine radicals formed in the initiation step collides with a neutral methane molecule, creating, importantly, hydrogen chloride as a product plus a methyl radical. Or you could have the methyl radical hitting a chlorine molecule to form one of the products, chloromethane, and a chlorine radical. There are various termination reactions, including two chlorine radicals combining to form a chlorine molecule, or two methyl radicals to form ethane, and there are other possibilities as well. Pause and have a go here. We've got an alkyl halide reacting with KCN, that's nucleophilic substitution. Reacting with ammonia, you would dissolve the ammonia and chloromethane in alcohol and warm them in a sealed tube. Again, that's nucleophilic substitution. And this is aqueous sodium hydroxide, and it's important to pick up on this whether it's aqueous or ethanolic. If it's aqueous, we get a substitution reaction. Had it been ethanolic or alcoholic sodium hydroxide, there was always the possibility of an elimination reaction, though with a single carbon in this molecule that wouldn't have happened. And have a go here as well, please. And here are the answers coming up. If you reacted with KCN, out comes the Cl and it's replaced with CN. What's the name of this chemical? It's a two-carbon chemical, so it's called eth. If you had been asked, it's known as ethane nitrile. Could also be called ethanonitrile. In this step, we reacted it with sodium hydroxide, and it's replaced the Cl with an OH. Again, nucleophilic substitution. In this case, reacted it with ammonia, and it's replaced the Cl with an NH2. This is an amine. Its name would be methanamine. This, of course, is methanol. The reaction is nucleophilic substitution. Specifically, it's substitution nucleophilic second order. The two refers to the fact that in the mechanism, in the rate determining step, the slow step, there are two molecules involved. In SN1, substitution nucleophilic first order, in that instance, there's only the organic molecule involved in the rate determining step. And the mechanism then for this reaction, this particular reaction here, have you tried it? Here's the answer coming up. This is the starting material, and here's our nucleophile. Should really be showing a pair of electrons there. There's a delta plus and a delta minus on here. This will come in from the opposite side. So you get Cl on one side on its way out, OH on its way in on the other side. This is coming in with a minus charge, so this intermediate should be shown with a minus charge. And then the chlorine will leave, taking both of these electrons with it. This negative charge is actually on the oxygen. It's got an extra electron, so when these two electrons both go out with the chlorine, that brings that carbon back to neutral again. And the chlorine has gone off with both electrons in this bond, so it goes off with an extra electron, which explains why it has a minus charge. In your syllabus, this is the important thing, the reaction intermediate. I'll take my scribbles off, just reflect upon that. Show the chlorine on its way out using a dashed line and the OH on its way in using a dashed line, but conserve the charge, neutral and negative. And when they combine, you have to conserve the charge, so the intermediate has a minus charge, which is specifically on this carbon here. And there's the product methanol formed together with the chloride ion. Pause and have a go, please. As we go down the group 7, if we look at the CX bond, CF, CCl, CBr, CI, reactivity increases as you go down. Now, there are two opposing arguments here that can be used, only one of which works. The electronegativity is decreasing as you go down. The electronegativity difference between the carbon and the fluorine is therefore going down, delta plus, delta minus. All of them have a delta plus, delta minus like that. But because iodine is considerably less electronegative than bromine or chlorine or fluorine, the polarity of this bond is weakening. And therefore the strength of the delta positive charge on the carbon is weakening, and it will therefore attract the OH minus nucleophile less strongly. On the basis of that, one would have expected reactivity to have decreased as you go down the group. In fact, it increases, and the reason it does so is because there is a counter argument to that, which is this: the CF bond is stronger than the CCl bond, which is stronger than the CBr bond, which is stronger than the CI bond. The weakest bond then is the CI bond. And since it's a weaker bond, this would dictate that it should react faster and undergo nucleophilic substitution faster. In this particular case, because reactivity is decreasing as you go down, this must be the dominant argument. So you'd have to bring that out in your answer. Pause and have a go at this, please. So we're comparing these two chemicals, chloromethane with methanol. What is it that methanol has that gives rise to stronger intermolecular forces? I think that's straightforward for 2 marks. Mention the type of bond that's present in one, present in the methanol, and not present in the chloromethane that gives rise to favourable attractions between those molecules and water molecules. Or in this case, explaining the higher boiling point that gives rise to stronger intermolecular forces between methanol molecules than between chloromethane molecules. And here are the answers coming up. We'll look at E first. Methanol can hydrogen bond for a mark, whereas chloromethane can't. It depends on dipole-dipole bonds, which are weaker. So you do have to identify the type of intermolecular force acting between chloromethane molecules. And then this is a difficult thing to tackle here in part D. Let's see how it brings this out. Iodomethane has a weaker CX bond than chloromethane. Chloromethane, however, is more polar than iodomethane, at least the CX bond is. So you have two counter arguments, and you may have to make the point that it's the bond enthalpy, the strength of the bond, that predominates. Do pause and take that information in and learn it almost verbatim. And that completes this particular test. Consider looking at others in the series. Thanks for listening.